probably heard the expression, no two snowflakes are alike. Well, the very same can be said about investors. Everyone has unique financial goals, life circumstances, risk tolerance, and investing style. So it makes sense that what's right for your portfolio isn't a one-size-fits-all proposition. Of course, that also makes figuring out that ideal mix of equities, fixed income, and cash a little tricky. But don't worry, there are some guidelines that can help you find your way. First off, let's recall those common investor profiles we introduced in our lesson, What Type of Investor Are You? If you didn't catch that one, check it out. It's a great primer for understanding who you are as an investor. There's conservative Cleo, whose aim is to generate steady yet tame returns and preserve her capital. An investor like Cleo may typically lean towards a 70-30 split between fixed income products like bonds and GICs on the higher end and large cap equities like stocks, mutual funds, and ETFs on the lower end. Then there's moderate Malik. Malik may be more comfortable with a balanced 40-60 mix of fixed income to equities, and he's willing to explore more growth-oriented mid-cap stocks and even some small-cap stocks too. Rounding out the trio is aggressive Andrea, who's more of a risk-taker. Their asset mix is in the neighborhood of 20-80 fixed income to equities and concentrated on earlier stage growth companies with the potential for high returns. Now, one thing you'll notice about each of these investing personas is that they all feature a combination of equities and fixed income. That's because diversification is a crucial part of building out a portfolio, regardless of your financial goals. You don't want your portfolio to live and die by the performance of a single type of investment. Instead, you want to spread your risk across several different asset classes. That way, you have a better chance of offsetting the losses in one with the gains in another. There are several different asset allocation strategies that investors might choose. We'll mention just three of them here, but make sure you explore the other alternatives before deciding what's right for you. Some investors opt for the strategic model based on the historical returns of different asset classes. They'll target a certain return they want to achieve on balance and buy an investment mix expected to deliver it. For example, let's say an investor is targeting a 7% annual return on their portfolio. If stocks have historically returned 10% per year and bonds 5%, they would settle on a 50-50 mix between the two. That's the 10% expected return from stocks plus the 5% expected return from bonds divided by 2, which equals 7.5%. However, this approach can lead to an imbalanced mix of asset classes over time, depending on how the asset classes actually perform. Some investors will want to regularly review their holdings to ensure they aren't taking on more risk than they intended. Other investors prefer the fixed-weighted strategy. This one keeps asset classes locked into a certain percentage of the total portfolio, regardless of how they perform. They might be the 30-70 split between bonds and stocks for an investor like conservative Cleo, or the 20-80 mix of bonds to stocks for those like aggressive Andrea. If one asset class loses value and dips below the percentage target, the investor would purchase more of it. And if that asset class climbs in value, they would sell some of it to rebalance. It's up to the investor to decide how much they'll allow an asset class to stray from that original target before bringing it back in line. Lastly, there's a tactical approach that leaves room for short-term deviations from a long-term asset mix. With this strategy, investors can choose to purchase investments they believe are exceptional opportunities, even if doing so would throw off their desired balance. Then, they would work to return their portfolio to its intended weightings by purchasing other assets over time. Now, figuring out your asset allocation strategy is one thing, but many new investors often wonder, how many investments should I hold? It's a great question with, surprise, surprise, no single answer. That said, a general rule of thumb is to hold only as many positions as you can adequately track and afford. Some investors who more actively manage their portfolios might make it so that each individual position accounts for a certain percentage of their total investment, say 3 to 5% apiece. Mutual funds and ETFs that are broadly diversified might account for a larger share, whereas more niche ones might make up a lower percentage. Or if you're like most passive investors who don't have the time or interest to follow individual stocks, you may opt for a handful of diversified mutual funds or ETFs. This is a common way for investors to quickly diversify their portfolios, even when starting out with just a few thousand dollars. Some managed portfolio funds even have the right asset mix built in to align with your profile, so you can sit back and relax without the need to rebalance. Regardless of the exact number of positions an investor chooses to hold, it's wise to have exposure to multiple asset classes and industries. Balance is key. Now, this might come as a bit of a surprise to some, but cash can be an important part of your asset mix too. Many investors are tempted to fully invest every dollar they have available. But that doesn't leave much room to pounce on investing opportunities that might pop up. Some investors turn to cash equivalents like treasury bills or bank deposit certificates that are easy to buy and sell as needed. That way, they're still potentially earning something with their cash rather than having it sit idle. Hopefully, you now have a better sense of how to find the asset mix that's right for you, and you can get your portfolio up and running. Don't forget to use the goals tool to help determine your investor profile and suitable asset mix. Of course, no portfolio is truly set it and forget it. You'll want to keep track of its progress and tweak things as you go. To learn how to do that, watch our lesson on keeping tabs on your portfolio's performance.